My name is Rajkumar. I'm the Vice Chancellor of OP Jindal Global University and Dean of Jindal Global Law School. It is indeed our proud privilege to partner with White & Case to organize this conversation on international arbitration. I'm here now to welcome our distinguished speaker for this evening. In fact, I can say that this entire seminar is woven around this evening's speaker, Mr. Fali Nariman, who obviously is well known to this audience. So let me quickly mention a little bit about Mr. Nariman and his work. Born in 1929 in Rangoon to Parsi parents, Sam Bariamji Nariman and Banu Nariman. Fali did his schooling from Bishop Cotton School, Shimla. Thereafter, he studied BA Honours in Economics and History from St. Xavier's College, Bombay, followed by a law degree from the Government Law College. I will do this. After standing first in the advocates examination and be awarded this Kinloch Forbes Gold Medal and Prize for Roman Law and Jurisprudence. His father initially wanted him to write the Indian Civil Service. Thank God for that. Since he could not afford it that time, he chose to study law, and that was his last option. Nariman started his law practice. You can go sit there. I'm going to finish this in another 3 minutes. Nariman started his law practice in the Bombay High Court. After practicing for 22 years, he was appointed as a senior advocate in the Supreme Court of India in 1971, a position he holds till date. He had argued some of the most landmark cases, which led to the significant development of Indian jurisprudence in a range of areas, not only limited to public law. I want to say that there are five aspects of his personality that has deeply shaped the growth and evolution of Indian legal profession. And since many lawyers are sitting here, it's important to mention that. First is intellectual rigor and his commitment to hard work. Second, his passion and dedication to the cause of law and justice. Third, his absolute integrity and honesty and rectitude in all the causes that he has exposed for. And fourth, his courage and conviction that he has spent his entire lifetime. And fifth, his ability to work towards inspiration and transformation. Generations of lawyers and judges in this country and beyond have been inspired by his work. He rarely combines the attributes of, first, being a persuasive lawyer, second, an outstanding jurist, and third, a committed parliamentarian. For many of you who may or may not be aware, he was a member of the Rajya Sabha and played a very distinguished role. A lawyer, imagine a lawyer taking out time to be part of the Rajya Sabha proceedings. However, I do feel that we missed him to be three other things. I believe he would have been a courageous judge if he chose to be a, if he had chosen to be a judge. He would have been an inspiring teacher, which we never had, and he would have been a prolific scholar and a researcher, which we also we never had. So with those words, I would like to welcome Mr. Fali Nariman to deliver a speech for this evening.
Of course, I wrote that out for him. So that was nice. My wife and I were not, I won't say entertained, but certainly very interested in the two sessions that we saw. The first was half of it, I think, and there was the second session particularly. And as to arbitrators becoming, having been drawn from the laity, as it were, not only from the law profession, I still remember the president of our ICC court in Paris, Robert Brina, told us that in a very heavy arbitration where there was one engineer and two lawyers, and the American lawyer said that, well, it will probably take about 3 months, and the Englishman said, no, it might take a little less, etc. But the engineer then managed to get the whole thing over within 4 days. And that's true. It is possible for a distinguished non-lawyer, person who has his head really close to the ground, is able to complete everything. And my regret always is in international arbitration that the arbitrator doesn't use the tools that he has. One of the tools in Indian arbitration in Hong Kong as well is that the arbitrator, he or she, must encourage mediation or conciliation. The same person can do it, and I see nothing wrong in the same person doing it. But I find that, unfortunately, in some of the arbitrations that are international arbitrations that I have sat in, that it's not done. The people don't just say anything at all. But you'd be surprised how much litigants, particularly commercial litigants, look upon every word that is said from the bench, and the bench includes the arbitration bench, as it were. And therefore, it's very, very important for arbitrators who are lawyers, who are judges, that they must try and encourage people to resolve the dispute. The idea of arbitration is not to go on with the dispute. That was why it is an alternative to litigation. This is the problem. Nobody seems to appreciate that. It's an alternative to litigation. And therefore, you can't go on in the same litigating spirit that you file your documents, you file the other documents, etc. Yes, you get them to file everything. Have a look at it. Find out what the common element is. And see that something is... You see, because the problem with arbitration as compared to mediation, and I, after many, many years of doing arbitration, I'm now convinced that it's been a failure in India, which I must tell you all. And the only method by which is for competent judges, competent lawyers to always engage the clients in trying to resolve the dispute. It's very easy to resolve the dispute. And they take the word of the judge, of the person from the bench, that look here, we think that this particular point may not be there, but you may have another point, etc. But this win all, lose all, mentality that we all have in arbitration, that you must win, you must lose. And the man who loses has to pay millions of pounds, and people get insolvent. That's why the new insolvency law. And you find all these fellows, because they borrow money from banks, and that's why they're all down in the dumps. Anyway, that's not my topic. My topic is wither arbitration, or what next for arbitration. So I think the Vice Chancellor was right. The engaging title is Cocktails and Conversation, because modern day international commercial arbitration, investment arbitration, far too complicated. We make it even more complicated. It's far too complex, exceedingly costly for being talked over soft drinks. You need a couple of stiff ones before clearing your throat and talking about arbitration. The problem today is that life is getting more and more difficult for arbitrators in international arbitration. The decision of arbitral tribunals are not only in the public domain, they are published, talked about, criticized at such events as this. The verdicts of tribunals in arbitration are almost like the off-the-cuff reaction of umpires on the cricket field when faced with an appeal of how's that. Modern cricket umpires on the field are now exposed, as you all see on television, to the cruel gaze of millions of television viewers, and their frailties are found out instantly. Why? This is with the help of an advanced digital computer system known as Hawkeye. All appeals in cricket are decided instantly, but not too sportingly. Not by the umpires in the field, but by that third umpire whom you can't see, who's sitting inside. There's no longer any prevarication about the question, would the ball have hit the wickets if it had missed the batsman's pads? Or the inevitable question, did the bat of the batsman running to the wicket cross the line before the ball bails were removed? The umpire on the field is too often overruled by the third umpire who sits in the cool shade. It's the technological eye of the third umpire is proving more accurate than the human eye of the umpire on the field. Now, why do I tell you all this? Because I foresee for the future, because everything is very fast changing in this technological age, some similar technological benchmark with reference to which awards in international arbitration can be graded with Hawkeye precision for rationality, fairness, and justness. They need to be. The most critical factor in all international arbitration is how arbitrators are to be chosen. As that hackneyed phrase goes, the jury is still out on this. Egalitarian has taken over and appears to be the order of the day. The trend is for an increasing number of arbitrators from different countries around the world to be appointed as arbitrator or chairman of tribunal, because it is hoped and expected this would help third world confidence in international commercial arbitration. But my friend Jan Paulsen, arbitrator emeritus, thinks otherwise. He once spoke at a gathering such as this on ethics and elitism in arbitration. He said to his audience that it was a mistake to think that it was a good thing for the international arbitration process if the greatest number of persons possible had the opportunity to act as arbitrators. And he ventured to suggest that given the high stakes and great sensitivities involved in all types of international arbitration, there was a good case for supporting the emergence and recognition of what he called an elite core of international arbitrators. But his speech was not at all well received by the audience. When sending me the text of it, Jan wrote in the margin, "Fali, have you ever been jeered at the end of the speech?" I have. And if you read the following pages, you will see why. It's true. So it is quite clear that public sentiment is that we must be more democratic, more liberal in the choice of arbitrator. If so, then I suggest we have as a what next, a change from the present system of challenges to arbitrators. This is very important. Under applicable arbitral rules or ad hoc practice around the world, the current system of challenge to the independence or impartiality of an arbitrator or a chairman of a tribunal, elitist or otherwise, is loaded, far too loaded in favor of the arbitrator challenge. My experience has been it is just not possible to get rid of an appointed arbitrator or chairman because of some reliable information in the possession of the challenging party, which he simply cannot prove in a court of law. And if he cannot prove it in a court of law, he can't present it. At present, there has to be disclosed some what is known as good reason, not suspicion, that the person already appointed is not likely to be impartial, which is almost an impossible task. But from ICSID, there comes some good news. Challenges to appointed arbitrators under the ICSID regime have been far more successful in recent years than in the past. In a trilogy of recent cases, they are known as the Blue Bank case, the Burlington and Karatuk, all decided in the last 2 or 3 years. Challenges to the independence of appointed arbitrators have succeeded by applying not the established standard of high probability of bias, but of a much lower standard of reasonable doubt. And this was hailed in an article which came out from in the Asian Dispute Review recently. And the author writes, and I quote, "It seems reasonable to surmise that the return to the lower standard of reasonable doubt as the threshold for disqualification of an institution is an institutional reaction to what at the core calls for greater accountability in the investor-state arbitration system. We definitely need more calls for greater accountability, both in international commercial arbitration and in investor-state arbitration." One of the topics of discussion today, and I heard it when we just came in, was about investment treaty arbitration. It said rise in investment treaty arbitration. I'd suggest a change in title towards a fall in investment treaty arbitration is the more appropriate title, because Indian experience has been far too painful to bear repetition. We in India have been badly bitten by investment treaties and bad decisions on them, which had been signed with flourish. And please remember that these decisions, unlike decisions in court, are not appealable. They are final, they are binding, whosoever deals with it. Much rethinking and much rewriting of bilateral investment treaties is needed. And my unsolicited advice is avoid BITs. They have not helped, and they will not help the Indian economy. We are better off without them. So far, they have been only invitations to financial disaster for India and the developing world. BIT has obliged governments to conduct their relations with foreign investors in a transparent fashion. Good. But if so, reciprocal, if not identical, obligations lie on the foreign investor as well, none of which is the obligation to make investments in accordance with the host state's domestic law. But this never happens. As is often observed, respect for the integrity of the law of the host state is a critical part of international investment law. But my experience has been that such observations are neglected, not applied to whatever case there is at hand. This is because international investment arbitration, although it has gained third world recognition, it has not yet gained third world confidence. The non-aligned world is dead, but the term third world survives. It is now used interchangeably with least developed as well as developing countries. The most constructive criticism of BITs has been from that liberal and prestigious international weekly, The Economist. And may I read it, what they said? They called it, it was headed, the arbitration game. And it said that multinationals have exploited woolly definitions of expropriation to claim compensation for changes in government policy that happen to have harmed their business. Number two, that this is the comment of The Economist, that the rise in contentious arbitrations is only because companies or corporations have never learned how to exploit arbitral causes, even going so far as buying off firms in jurisdiction where they do not operate only to gain access to them. This happened in a famous arbitration in the Seychelles, where there was that poor fellow, I don't know if you've ever read of that, there was only one lawyer there, the Attorney General. He was also Attorney General, he was also everything. And he knew very little arbitration law. And there was a massive claim against the little island of Seychelles. And the British came in great force with all their lawyers and so on and so forth. And ultimately, which is a great misfortune, and this has been commented on, there was a solemn award against the Seychelles Islands of some millions and millions of pounds. And this led to, at one of our international conferences, I think it was in Singapore or Manila, where the recommendation was that for countries who required assistance as to how to conduct arbitrations, etc., we should have a little cell which they could rely upon. Because that poor fellow, the Attorney General, appeared himself and made a big hash of it, and he couldn't do a thing about it. And that is required, please remember, because there are investments, massive investments by large companies, capital-worthy companies, and the problem is that sometimes, due to some defaults, etc., the country which receives the investment is not able to repay it in time, etc., which leads to arbitration. But you must know the techniques of arbitration. You must know how to deal with it. And most of the countries in the world, I mean, we are an exception, some of us, but otherwise very few of them know how to deal with these international investment arbitration. And most of the time, it's the capital exporting countries which have the majority of arbitrators, or as I noticed in one arbitration where I was chairman, that the Bangladesh, which happened to be the other party, did not appoint anybody because they felt that it was wrong. Very stupid of them, but they didn't. So the ICSID had to appoint another arbitrator for that company. And this was a massive claim by an international corporation against the government of Bangladesh, who didn't know how to conduct any arbitration at all. So, unfortunately, and the last part which The Economist says, and I'll read it to you, that the secretive nature of the arbitration process and the lack of any requirement to consider precedent, except their own, because you only follow some other award, somebody has said something, allows plenty of scope for what The Economist has called creative adjudications. There have been many creative adjudications in this field of investment arbitration. Is all this criticism valid? I suppose some of it is, but it can be improved. And my suggestions are, one, clauses in BITs must not be simply replicated from some model generally offered by the home state. They must be seriously negotiated at arm's length between the two states, and when necessary, with the assistance of those competent and familiar with treaty making. Treaty making is a difficult art. Everybody can't draft treaties, just as everybody can't draft laws, or everybody can't draft a proper statement of case. So you have to go to the expert to do it. But most people don't realize this. Second, the absence of a level playing field disables the developing host state from making an effective defense to investors' claims in arbitration. Even if the BIT as signed ensures more protection to investors in the host state without any compensating safeguards for the latter, when a dispute arises, and this is where you, when you are an arbitrator, you must always remember, whether you are from the first world or the third world, efforts must be made to establish equality in arbitration. The essence of arbitration is equality in arbitration. Both sides must appear to be equal and have the equal strength to deal with arguments from one to the other. Next, we must explode the myth about the infallibility of international arbitral tribunals. Believe me, they are fallible. And we must acknowledge they are sometimes, not often, but definitely sometimes, biased. And we must provide adequate safeguards against this. This is my firm view, having sat on ICSID tribunals about 10 or 12 times. I'm of this view. Since an award rendered by an international investment arbitral tribunal is final and binding, and since recourse against it on merits is not available in courts of law, either in the New York Convention or UNCITRAL or even ICSID, there is a felt need for provision being made in the treaty itself for an appeal or at least an agreed internal mechanism. I don't find this in your new Indian BIT. I don't know why, but that's very, very important. To enable the arbitral tribunal to review its own award. We all make mistakes. There may be a mistake in calculation of the quantum, etc. At the instance of the party agreed, the correction of obvious and patent errors, even for correction of errors not so patent, is very essential. Now we come to a less controversial topic, which is how to conduct an transnational arbitration. In the absence of any universally recognized standard-setting body, the practical aspect of how international commercial arbitration is conducted depends very much on the composition of the tribunal. Statutes and conventions lay down general principles. Arbitrators must be quick, free of bias, respect the limits of their authority, treat both parties with equality, and so on and so on. And the arbitral institutions give a very wide discretion, how facts are to be proved, how contracts are to be interpreted. Incidentally, on contracts, some of you wondered whether we have sufficient law to allow claims for damages and something to draw on by way of precedent. Please remember, we are amongst the 42 common law nations in the world, in the entire world, and we have a lot to draw from the common law. We don't have the law, I agree, entirely correct. It's not built up as it should be. Contract law is in very poor shape. Yeah, our contract text is of the year 1872. It needs revision, but it's never been, nobody's thought of it, nobody's bothered about it, nobody will, I think, in the not too distant future. So, but we have the common law, and the common law is part of our constitution. Please remember that. Article 372 has preserved it of the constitution. Go back and look at Article 372 of our constitution. It says the law in force, which before the constitution came into effect, is part of the law of India. And that law was and is still the common law. And the common law is an amazing set of judicial decisions where case by case, you have it in Canada, you have it in Australia, you have it in New Zealand, you have it in England, where they build up the common law, which accounts for a lot of injustices being removed from case to case. And that helps you. And that's why Chitty on Contracts, which is such a bulky thing in two volumes, is a magnificent book, and it's kept, you keep updating it from time to time. But parties from different cultural backgrounds feel shortchanged or unfairly treated with regard to matters like cross-examination, discovery, calling of experts, and so on. As my friend Rusty Park puts it, Rusty Park is a professor in Boston, he's a famous arbitrator, that parties from different cultural backgrounds that are not Western are sometimes made to feel that they are playing American football and British rugby at the same time, never knowing whether or when the ball can be thrown. So the question is not what are the due process sine qua nons, but whether the arbitral tribunal is sensitive to and is prepared to accommodate cultural differences of parties, even amongst members of the same tribunals. How should a mixed arbitral tribunal function when it comprises members reared in different legal disciplines in different cultural backgrounds? I've had the privilege of sitting with people who are from Italians and so on, I'm from European and American, and it's fascinating. You learn a lot. I learned a lot. The answer is one must function only in a spirit of collegiality. About speed, over the years, American judges have discovered a good way to stop long-winded lawyers. I've seen this myself when some of us went on a special Indo-American legal forum, as it was called. They sit in court, the judges, with a stopwatch, setting a time limit. I've seen this, of say 10 minutes or 15 minutes. It's written on the list. The list outside says so-and-so, so-and-so, 10 minutes, so-and-so, so-and-so, 20 minutes, and so on, for the lawyer on each side to argue. And I've seen in a court proceeding in Washington, a federal court, where in the midst of a heated argument, the judge interrupts and says, looking at her stopwatch, it was a lady judge, "Mr. Murphy, you have 2 minutes left. Will you take it now, or do you take it in reply to your learned friend?" And Mr. Murphy immediately sits down, mid-sentence, because he wants that precious 2 minutes in reply. He doesn't want to exhaust them at the beginning. I've often wondered if the same thing were to happen in arbitration. This is your what next in arbitration. This is very important. Setting of time limits by arbitrators. How would American, English, or Indian courts react to the plea that one of the parties was hustled and unable to present his case in conformity with due process? Of course, I have not known of any American or Indian arbitrator setting time limits so far. But surely this is where we must consider whether ample due process does not impede speedy arbitrations, even in one and the same Anglo-Saxon cultural tradition. I have not investigated how strict time limits under modern court systems in the US got introduced. But please remember, in international arbitration, we learn from different cultures. And I can tell you certain countries in the continent of Africa would not be surprised if such strict limits were preset by arbitrators being observed by the parties. Among certain tribal communities in the continent of Africa, when there are disputes between two groups, they all go before the chief, who sits on a throne covered with a lion's skin. He listens and listens to the spokesperson from each side. But the rule is, the spokesperson can only speak as long as he can say what he wants to say on one leg. The moment that leg comes down, his speech is over. There's a story, of course this is a story, probably apocryphal, about one smart guy from the tribe who had the benefits of a school and college education. He tried to be too smart. The rule said, you must argue and present your case standing only on one foot. But the rule did not say on which foot. So this wise guy said what he had to say on his left foot. And when his left foot got tired, he put it down and began arguing on the right foot. And so on. But retribution is swift in African customary law. Infraction of unwritten rules are looked upon far more seriously than transgression of written arbitral rules. The wise guy paid for being too smart with an award of 20 lashes. Quite seriously, this is not quite the case when legal cultures collide. But how does one comport oneself in other places with other times, other manners, as Goldsmith used to say? In the matter of impartiality and independence, we have now the IBA guidelines, with three of the principal colors of the rainbow. But cultural approaches in different parts of the world make it impossible to prescribe a worldwide standard. For instance, I don't know if you know this, there's a rule, written rule, in the arbitration law in the People's Republic of China, a provision not found in the arbitration law of any country. It stipulates that an arbitrator must recuse himself or withdraw from an arbitration, not only where he is or she is close relative or has a personal interest, but also where, and I quote, the arbitrator has privately met with the other party or his agent or even accepted an invitation for entertainment, including dinner. Article 34.4, which only goes to show how important appearances are among some people. Where two arbitrators on opposite sides dine together, the other fellow accuses him, and the rules apart, your arbitrator, my arbitrator, having a convivial meal together is not viewed with great favor in this part of the world as well, I can assure you. One of them, surely, the one who didn't pay the bill must have been bought over. Whatever the cultural differences in different parts of the world, the majority of international arbitrations are conducted in English. Arbitral awards are also written mainly in English. English is the language of this century, and at least for perhaps another 25 years, unless Brexit falls out of Europe. To all arbitrators, I would recommend that they be proficient in the language they know, because of the familiarity with various shades of meaning of words. It's very, very difficult. English is a very, very difficult language. There's much misunderstanding in arbitration, and this is a true story which I'm telling you, when cultures clash. I recall a case concerning a senior colleague of mine. He's a Swedish gentleman. The famous Swedish judge, Nils Mangard. I don't know if you ever heard of him. Very nice person. He was extremely soft-spoken, man of great rectitude. But he got into serious trouble when he was a sitting judge in the Iran-US tribunal. On one occasion, the Iranians protested bitterly about what they considered to be very prejudicial remarks of Judge Mangard. It appears that during the hearing of a case before the Iran-US tribunal, the judge was heard to say, quietly, softly, he was a very soft-spoken chap, he was shocked to hear about the execution of judges in Iran. There were howls of protest from the Iranian advocates, complete confusion written on the face of the judge. Judge Mangard said again softly, he had been misunderstood. He said he was only complaining about the execution of judgments in Iran, not execution of judges in Iran. It's true, absolutely true story, but there's a sequel to it. It led to a diplomatic incident because the dispute became so serious that everyone concerned lost his sense of balance and sense of humor. And this dispute as to what Judge Mangard really said had to be referred to arbitration of a judge from the Netherlands, who was also a gentleman who had no sense of humor. Instead of bringing both parties together and getting the misunderstanding settled, he solemnly proceeded with the arbitration, produced a 50-page report. I've been trying to get that report, must be in Dutch, but I can't get it. It should be very interesting. In which he concluded that Iran had not proved its case. And the moral of the story is, that as arbitrator, you must speak up. Make yourself understood to parties whose main language is not in English. But don't do the converse, as some of my English friends do. Don't show off in French if you are English speaking. On one occasion, when Britain's former prime minister, this is probably not true, it's half true, Tony Blair went to Paris. He made a short speech. He thought he would flatter his host, who was the then French Prime Minister. He meant to say how much he admired Monsieur Jospin in many ways. But after he had spoken, his audience was appalled, because what he actually said in French was that he desired Monsieur Jospin in so many different positions. As I said, this is half true. The moral of the story is always stick with the language of communication you are used to. Don't experiment, don't show off in a lingo whose idioms you don't completely comprehend. The expression due process does not mean the same thing as fairness, even on two sides of the Atlantic. Standards of fairness vary in different legal circles. There's a story and this is true. About Sadincha Mullah, I never met him, but he was a marvelous, must have been a marvelous individual, one of our greatest jurists who wrote the Civil Procedure Code commentary, the Criminal Procedure Code, the Hindu law. A solicitor whom we had met in years ago in chambers in Bombay, he wanted advice as to whether his client should file a suit. So he marched off with his client to consult Mullah, Dincha Mullah. He gave the facts and Mullah Shadi said, and he said, no. But what if we put it this way, the solicitor said. He said, no, you can't do it. Solicitor would not give up. He said, sir, Dinsha, suppose we say this. Now, Dinsha was firm, but he wasn't stupid. He could see that the solicitor desperately wanted that his client should file a suit. So he said, tell me, Pochkanawala, is your client a sporting chap? The client who was present chipped in, yes, sir, I am a sporting chap. So then the mullah said, then fire away. The client fired away. He filed his suit, which was ultimately dismissed with costs, down 30,000 rupees, a very large sum of money in the early 1900s. So don't let your client get into the sporting chap syndrome when he suggests international arbitration, because it's damned expensive. Give good legal advice before taking the first step. Negotiate, and only when negotiations fail, embark on the risky and costly experiment of arbitration. I think we should stop. There's just one other story. Would you like to hear it? Okay, good. In some places that are not in the Western world, what is considered more important even than impartiality and independence is the state of the arbitrator's mind. How do you know what sort of a fellow he is, what he's thinking? My friend, and this is true, and one-time colleague on the ICC court, Monsieur Toshio Sawada, Japanese, once showed me a specially tailored arbitration clause that he had come across in Japan, and he translated it for me. He assured me that the clauses I will now read to you are not a product of his imagination. They were actually negotiated, agreed to in a construction contract executed by a Japanese party with a German engineering firm many years ago. And they provided for contingencies which no arbitration clause has ever provided for. When cultures collide, we must live and learn. So let me read one or two of these clauses. I quote, should either party come to feel that the arbitrator is insane for reasons it comes to know after commencement of the arbitration, it may consult the other party. And should both parties agree that the arbitrator is likely to be insane, they shall serve a notice of doubt on the arbitrator. Causes giving rise to notice of doubt must be extreme and not be limited to continuous making of senseless remarks and speeches or absent-mindedness. And some of you might qualify, including me. Absent-mindedness and queer conduct, and parties may serve a notice of doubt only once during the arbitration. You can't have too many times. On such notice of doubt being served, the arbitrator may not refuse medical examination by a psychiatrist specialist at one of the hospitals listed in Appendix 1, Appendix 2, and made a part hereof. If in the opinion of the psychiatrist specialist, the examination would require more than 4 weeks, or if the psychiatrist specialist is unable to conclude that the arbitrator is positively insane, the arbitrator shall be deemed to be not insane. The medical examination shall be at the party's cost and shall be conducted on condition that the result will be made known only to the arbitrator and the parties, no publication. If the arbitrator is found insane, he shall resign, in which event he shall not be entitled to the fee for the services he has rendered. But each party shall pay to the arbitrator a get-well fee of 100,000 yen and one half of the disbursements covering the amount the arbitrator will have expended in connection with the arbitration. If the arbitrator is found not insane as a result of the examination, the parties shall jointly provide him with a letter of apology and each party shall pay a so sorry fee of 1 million yen to the arbitrator, which he may treat as damages for tax purposes. The arbitrator may not count the time spent for medical examination as time spent for arbitration. And last, while the provisions of these clauses are not intended to permit parties to take the arbitrator to the hospital by dint of force, can't take it. It does not bar the parties from initiating judicial proceedings for removal of the arbitrator. Such proceedings may be resorted to only where the arbitrator refuses to subject himself to medical examination, or where the parties are not satisfied with the findings of the psychiatrist that the arbitrator is not insane. If parties initiate judicial proceedings and fail to remove the arbitrator, each party shall pay a nuisance fee of 2 million yen to the arbitrator. And during such proceeding, the arbitration may proceed, but the arbitrator may not render an award. If rendered, such award may not be enforced. End of quote. Ladies and gentlemen, Shakespeare was right. There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy and in mine. With such detailed sanity clauses in place, international arbitrators face the prospect of being compensated with a get-well fee or a so-sorry fee or a nuisance fee, even when they do not perform their arbitral function. Despite all you have heard today, the future of arbitration is bright, perhaps only because the future of litigation is not. An English judge who did not wish to be quoted once famously said, "Litigation is an activity that has not markedly contributed to the happiness of mankind." If arbitration is not to suffer the same fate, I would suggest arbitrators around the world would raise their sights and adopt a culture-conscious transnational outlook. At a conference I attended in Geneva some years ago, to a question as how to conduct a transcultural international arbitration, the given answer was, like you make an omelette. The ingredients differ in different parts of the world, but the breaking of eggs is the only common factor. The same goes for differing procedural expectations. A countryman from mine from India found when he was in London that he had a severe toothache. So he went off to a Harley speech specialist, no other would do. The doctor took one look at the offending tooth and told him, "I can relieve you of your pain, sir, by extracting your tooth. It will take me just 3 minutes, but it will cost you £300. £300 for 3 minutes? Said my Indian colleague, doubling up with more pain. "Well," said the judge, "dentist, I could do it more slowly." So let me end with a plea to the world's international arbitration. Never use due process as an excuse, and whatever the provocation, for God's sake, don't do it slowly. Thank you.